Well, welcome to 700 Club Interactive. This week, we've been taking a look at how people throughout history have searched for God. And in today's show, we're going to talk about Buddhism. And the followers of Buddhism are committed to a life of devout discipline and meditation.
For Buddhists, the highest goal is nirvana, the removal of all desires and attachments. The word nirvana actually means to extinguish. Buddhists believe that an individual must extinguish the self in order to reach nirvana. It's a state of godlike perfection.
Around the world, 350 million Buddhists are striving for one thing, nirvana.
When one reaches nirvana, it all ends there. The person has been extinguished.
In Buddhism, there is no creator, no supreme God, and no salvation but yourself.
I was taught that you are your own strength. You have to achieve your own glory and achieve spiritual improvement by yourself.
To reach nirvana is to extinguish the self, a nearly impossible task.
In my opinion, reaching nirvana seems a hopeless situation.
More than 2,000 years ago, a nobleman named Siddhartha Gautama went on a quest to overcome suffering and death. Through self-discipline and meditation, he believed that he had finally achieved nirvana. After that, he became known as the Buddha, or Enlightened One. Buddha claimed that he had found the cause of human suffering and the way to end it. He then laid out his four noble truths. All existence is suffering. Human desire or attachment causes this suffering. Humans can end suffering by putting an end to their selfish desires. The fourth truth says that the only way to achieve nirvana is to follow the Eightfold Path, a series of mental and behavioral guidelines. This path is illustrated by the Dharma wheel, one of the most important symbols of Buddhism. It represents the endless cycle of life through rebirth. The wheel is divided into three sections: wisdom, ethical conduct, and mental development. For Buddhist monks, following the path demands that they leave everything behind, even their families, to focus on perfecting themselves.
People who really want to achieve nirvana need to remove themselves from society and leave everything in order to keep their minds and soul peaceful. Therefore, the ones who have achieved nirvana are mostly monks. After entering monkhood, there are 227 rules that need to be followed. Those who want to achieve nirvana need to meditate at all times. One cannot allow his feelings or emotions to overtake them. The soul needs to be pure and free from any emotion or sadness. That person's soul needs to be pure, bright, and peaceful all the time. Only then can he achieve nirvana.
And there's no supreme God to help you achieve nirvana. In Buddhism, the fate of your soul depends entirely on you.
Each of us has our own responsibility, and each of us does suffer because of our confusion. But if we come to understand, we can free ourselves from suffering even in this life, much less waiting for someone else to do it for us anytime.
And if you don't get it right in this life, Buddhists believe there's always the next.
The cyclic existence is a process of rebirths in order for each soul to make amends for their bad karma, all the karma that one has built up during a lifetime. If one kills and eats an animal, that person will be born as an animal during his next life. The chances for a soul to be born as a human being in order to improve their spirituality, their karma, and be able to achieve nirvana are very slim. It is very hard.
Buddha's whole teaching was is that there is no separated self. It's a hard road because you realize that ultimately you can't really have nirvana until all beings have nirvana. So then that makes it really tough.
It does make it really tough. When you start understanding what is the ultimate purpose of nirvana, it's the extinguishing of yourself and your consciousness. And for you to effectively achieve nirvana, it means that all people, all conscious beings, not just people, but animals, fish, have to achieve nirvana with you. And when you do that, then you get it. Now, when does that happen? Well, they say it's some far-off time, and you've got to go through an infinite number of lifetimes in order to achieve that. In some ways, that's very defeatist, so why should you try in this life, since you're eventually going to get there? Why even bother? And it also, it means that for you, there are consequences to what you do in this life, because you may be born later in a worse condition. And that's one of the fundamentals of reincarnation. It's both defeatist now, you know, what do I do now in life? And you never have this sense that you've made it, that you can have peace. Well, here's what the Bible specifically says about reincarnation. You find it in Hebrews chapter 9. And it is appointed for men to die once. So get that. Understand the Bible, there's no reincarnation in the Bible. It's appointed for men to die once. But after this, the judgment. So Christ was offered once to bear the sins of many. To those who eagerly wait for him, he will appear a second time, apart from sin, for salvation. It's the hope of the church. It's the hope of all believers that when Jesus comes again, we will be with him. We will no longer be under the curse that was pronounced over the earth. The reason there's suffering in this life is because of that curse. It's because of what we're under in terms of the law of sin and death. But when he comes again, we will be redeemed out of all of that. And in this life, we have assurance of that. We have what the Bible calls the down payment, the earnest money deposit, where we have his Holy Spirit. We can be partakers of his divine nature. We can taste and see that the Lord is good. We know where we're going. Now, what happens after the judgment, and what is the basis of the judgment? Well, you find that in Revelation chapter 7. After these things, I looked, and behold, a great multitude, which no one could number, of all nations, tribes, peoples, and tongues, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes, with palm branches in their hands, and crying out with a loud voice, saying, salvation belongs to our God, who sits on the throne, and to the Lamb. Now, there's going to be a time, and this is at the end of time, after Jesus comes back, where from every nation, from Thailand, from China, from Burma, from Vietnam, from Cambodia, from Japan, from the Buddhist, even from those nations, they will come gathered in white robes saying, salvation belongs to our God and to the Lamb. Now, who are these people? Well, answer comes from Revelation. In the same chapter, chapter 7, then one of the elders answered, saying to me, who are these arrayed in white robes, and where did they come from? And I said to him, sir, you know. So he said to me, these are the ones who came out of the great tribulation. And that's the time we're living in now, the great tribulation. And washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. If you want salvation, if you want to know peace with God, if you want to know that your sins are forgiven and that the wall of separation between you and God is now gone, if you want to experience him, if you want to hear his voice
and understand Jesus is real. How do you do that? Well, you take on the garment that he has so freely provided. Don't come to the wedding feast of the Lamb dressed in your own righteousness. Come with the garment that he gives, which is washed in his blood. And when you accept his sacrifice and say, that sacrifice is sufficient for me. It covers all my sin, the ones that I have committed, even the ones I have not yet committed. It covers them all, because that's how complete a salvation he gives. When you believe that, when you enter into that, and you ask him, open my ears that I may hear your voice, give me a heart of understanding that I may know the greatness of your power towards us who believe. Show me. It's one of the great prayers. Jesus, if you're there, if you can hear my voice, if you came for me, would you show me? When you ask that, he'll answer. He'll show up for you. It's not about perfecting yourself. It's not about how much meditation you can do, how many good thoughts you can think, how much you can remove yourself from this life, how sinless you can be. It's all about him and what he did. And he's just a prayer away. If you want that salvation, if you want to have peace with God, if you want to know that your Redeemer lives, and on that day you'll stand on the earth and you'll be able to see him face to face, if you want that, all you have to do is call us. It's a toll-free number, 888-777-1999. There'll be somebody on the other end of that phone who has prayed the same prayer and has gone through an experience that we call the rebirth. It's the renewing of your spirit, renewing of your mind, where you finally know you have peace with God. If you want that, call us. We'll lead you in a wonderful prayer. We've also got a free packet for you. It's called A New Day, where how do you live the Christian life? What is all this about? What do I do now? And it's about getting into God's Word. It's about reading the Bible on a daily basis. It's about renewing your mind so that you understand the good news of what Jesus Christ has done for us all. Well, up next, a Buddhist who suffered with arthritis for years with no relief. Watch how she found a cure next on 700 Club Interactive.
It's hard to believe it's been 8 years since I made that commercial. And now I'm a 10-year survivor.
Today's a special day, a big milestone to me. I'm out here riding my horse, appreciating every minute of it.
My life changed the day I was diagnosed with cancer. It was hard when I was lying in the hospital and didn't know if anybody survived pancreatic cancer. But I decided,
if I survive this, I want to offer hope to somebody else.
And to show them that there are people out there like Cancer Treatment Centers of America who can make a difference.
To find out more about Cancer Treatment Centers of America and our unique treatment options for complex and late-stage cancer, go to cancercenter.com. You'll be able to see our treatment results for many types of cancers and how they compare to national averages. You can also check for participating insurance plans.
The doctors looked over what they needed to do for me, but the decision was always mine.
At Cancer Treatment Centers of America, every resource, every one of us, everything we do every day is focused on you, our patient, your treatment, your healing, your survival.
After cancer now, I just appreciate life so much more. I appreciate the little things.
Being able to carry a bucket of water for my horse again was like winning a marathon. Not 1 hour goes by that I don't stop and think about how fortunate I was to have found CTCA.
Our teams of physicians, clinicians, and nurses are highly experienced and dedicated. We use state-of-the-art technology and give you innovative treatment options you may not even know exist. You'll also experience whole-person, compassionate care here, unlike anything you've seen before.
When I talk to people, they said, oh my gosh, a 10-year survivor, I can't believe it. Life is good, and I just appreciate it totally. I'm doing things I never dreamt I would do.
Call or go to cancercenter.com today to learn more about our unique approach to state-of-the-art cancer care. Cancer Treatment Centers of America, care that never quits.
In Indonesia, CBN produces a program called Solusi. It's the Indonesian version of the 700 Club and the show one Buddhist was watching when her pain finally ended.
For weeks, Millie had been experiencing pain and swelling in her right hand and wrist.
My hand would just throb. I couldn't do laundry or scrub pans. I cried every night.
Millie scraped together the money to see a doctor. He diagnosed the condition as a form of arthritis and gave her some medicine, but the pills didn't work.
The pain would go away for maybe 5 minutes. Then it came back worse than before.
Millie went to the temple to pray.
I was a Buddhist. I bowed down asking Buddha for healing. I burned incense. I told him my hand hurt so bad.
After 2 years suffering with the condition, Millie's husband told her about a Christian TV program he'd seen called Solusi, the Indonesian version of the 700 Club. Millie called the CBN prayer line and asked for help.
I thought to myself, if my hand could be healed, I wanted to follow Jesus.
That's when the miracle happened.
A couple of days later, I said to my husband, my hand is healed. My hand was healed by God. My husband said, whoa, we need to start praying to Jesus.
The couple started watching Solusi together, and soon they prayed with the host to receive Jesus as Savior. When Melly went back to the doctor, he was stunned by what he saw and heard.
He asked me if I had gone to another doctor. I said no. It's because of Jesus through the television.
Today, Melly is pain-free and joyful in her new faith in Christ.
I watched Solusi and my hand is healed, and I am following Jesus now. God used that program to touch my life.
In a very deep and eternal, permanent way. And that's what you're helping to do when you join the 700 Club. We just want to invite you to be a part of letting people around the world know how much God loves them, how He longs to have relationship with them, and how His power is always extended to His children, wanting to work on their behalf to meet their needs. Help us to do that, won't you? If you've not joined the 700 Club, it's a very simple process. It's a commitment of 65 cents a day, that's $20 a month, and it makes you a 700 Club member. And you join with thousands of people who are saying, we want others around the world to know how much God loves them, to know who Jesus is, to have new life and eternal life as well. So help us to tell that message. Join us now. Call 888-777-1999, or you can log on to cbn.com and join with us that way. But when you do, will you use something called Pledge Express? It's electronic monthly giving, and what it means is your bank does all the work. You have none of the hassle, so you don't have to remember when to mail in your pledge or your gift. You don't have to have envelopes or stamps on hand. The bank does the whole thing for you. Saves us some processing costs, so we can put even more of your gift into the lives of people like Melly and her family. And our way of saying thank you for using Pledge Express is to send you a Power for Life teaching each month. These are teachings that we receive here at CBN, and we'd love to share them with you. We think they'll be a blessing to you. So call that number right now, 1-888-777-1999. Just say, I want to join the 700 Club. You'll be glad you did. Well, coming up, we've received your questions. Todd asks, I am a Buddhist and I recently began to believe in Jesus Christ. Is it okay to believe in Buddha and Jesus Christ? Well, we're going to answer that question and more right after this.
Women who work at these institutions will have access to free contraceptive services.
Some say it's about access to birth control.
That really is above his pay grade. That's not a power the government has.
Others, religious freedom.
And you don't get to say, because some Catholics willingly do something, I can force the rest of them to do it in violation of their rights.
What the Constitution says about the latest health care debate.
It's a distinction without a moral difference. It doesn't change anything.
On the 700 Club, next.
If you're the mother of a child with behavior problems, I'd like to talk to you. My name is Janet Lehman, and I'm a behavioral therapist and a mom. I know what it's like when the child that you love becomes a defiant, out-of-control child who disrespects you.
That's why my husband James and I created the Total Transformation, the program that tens of thousands of moms are now using to turn around their child's behavior.
If you've heard about the Total Transformation and wondered if it will work for you, now you can try it for free. I'm willing to give away 1,000 programs today for free.
All you need to do is get the program and let us know how it works for you. We'll let you keep it for free.
I know the total transformation works because I used these techniques with my own son and with troubled kids for over 30 years. Let me prove to you that it works by giving you the program free.
Call the number on your screen now to get the total transformation free.
Well, we've received your questions in our inbox. This is from Todd, who writes, I am a Buddhist and I recently began watching 700 Club Interactive. I really enjoy the show, and I now believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and the Bible. Is it okay to believe in Buddha and Jesus Christ at the same time?
Todd, you're doing exactly what the Chinese did back in the 7th century. A group of Nestorian Christians led by Alapin came to visit the emperor of China, and they had great success in preaching the gospel, but there was something that happened, and the term theologically is syncretism. And the great Nestorian monument, which still survives, that talks about how great Christianity is, has the cross coming out of a lotus flower. There are parallels in Buddhist thought and Christian thought, specifically the Apostle Peter talking about inordinate desire, which is the proper translation of a Greek word, which ends up being translated in English, lust. The Apostle John talks about the pride of life, the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, all of which Buddhism tries to get rid of. But when you look at the main tenet, the first noble truth, all existence is suffering, that is completely incompatible with Christianity, where Jesus said, I came that you might have life and have it more abundantly. So instead of trying to extinguish life, he's trying to give it to you more abundantly and take you out of the law of sin and death. Where you start to understand you have all things. You don't have to desire anything because you already have it. Paul said, I possess all things. He wrote that from prison. So what kind of transformation do you need to go through in your thought process to arrive there? I would leave all existence is suffering behind and say all existence with Jesus is a joy.
Well, this is Tim who says, what's the difference between good karma and God's rule of you reap what you sow?
Karma is death. You can't break from it. And then on top of it, it's the karma from past lives, which we've already gone into. There's no reincarnation in Christianity. What the law of reaping and sowing exists in Christianity, but the great news is Jesus takes away all the consequences for that and makes you justified, which means just as if you never did it. When you have that kind of understanding, you can walk free in Christ, walk free from karma, walk free from the law of sin and death, and have life. Well, on our next story, for years, John Gordon thrived on positive thinking. He even made a living out of it as a motivational speaker. Then one day, John was driving to a speaking engagement when he heard a voice that spoke directly to him.
I believe every one of us has a choice between two roads, the positive road and the negative road. And the positive road leads to joy, success, and fulfillment. And the negative road leads to failure, negativity, and despair.
John Gordon has been down both roads. Today, he's a motivational speaker who coaches huge corporations and national sports teams. But a while back, nothing but negativity filled his mind. In a six-month period, John lost his job with a technology company, almost went bankrupt, and almost lost his marriage.
I was so emotionally immature, didn't know how to deal with my stress, didn't know how to deal with my fear, didn't know how to deal with the pressure of being a young dad with two kids and a wife to support. And I was a guy who, when I was in my 20s, people said, wow, you have the world ahead of you, you have so much potential. I was 24 years old and I was considered one of the up-and-comers in Atlanta, a rising star, someone who was really making a difference in the community. And everything was about always accomplishing something, and now I wasn't accomplishing anything. I was failing in everything. So I blamed everyone else. I blamed my parents, my upbringing, my biological father who left when I was one. I blamed my wife. So it was everyone else's fault, but mine.
It was just always nitpicking, always something that he was noticing that we weren't doing right. And I told him, you know what? I'd rather live alone and struggle and try to make ends meet than to live with you and deal with this kind of negativity. And so I pretty much said I was going to divorce him.
That got John's attention.
couple days later, I got this sort of eureka moment. Writing and speaking just came to me. And I started just to research for myself positive ways to change my own life.
John put what he was learning into practice, starting at home. So Catherine decided to stay in the marriage. Then he began writing and speaking about positive energy. John's teachings came from a collection of religions and beliefs.
My belief was that all paths led to God, and that you really, Jesus was just one path. That through Buddhism, you can get there as well. And through Hinduism, you can get there. And through just having a spiritual relationship with Father God, you can connect.
John became known as the Energy Guy. He even appeared on the Today Show. Then his success came to an end.
The sales just stopped, sort of speaking, sort of dried up. But it was during this process that God started to change me and start to know that there was something more.
John grew up in a Jewish-Italian family. Apart from being bar mitzvahed, he never went to temple or church.
So organized religion to me was a bunch of people getting together and practicing things that didn't really do anything. It was a lot of hypocrisy to me.
Then a good friend gave John some sermons on CDs about Jesus.
I never used to think that I needed saving, but now I was introduced to the idea of that God came here to save you. And it was after listening to those CDs that on my walk of prayer in the morning, I said, God, if there is something to this Jesus, if he is who they say he is, just show me the signs. I'm open to them. I'm open. So I'm driving down to Orlando to speak. I'm on I-95 South, and I'm looking to the left, and I just heard this voice said that, look, and I turn, and I look, and I see this sign that says, Jesus is the answer. And in that moment, I knew that it was a sign from God. It was meant for me.
While John was meditating, he started seeing glowing crosses. He told a Buddhist energy healer about all these things he was seeing, and he was surprised at the Buddhist response.
He said, Christianity is like spiritual cheating. He said, you just believe, and then you receive. And I had tried everything before that to get rid of this burden, to get rid of this knot that I had in my stomach, this constant anxiety, this fear, this anxiousness that was just sort of was in me at all times. And every technique, every new age kind of process just didn't work. I just said, Jesus, I make you my Lord and Savior. Please save me. Take my burden, take my pain. I can't do it alone. He just started to change me in a lot of ways, a better father, a better husband. I started to judge others a lot less. I used to have a lot of judgment. And also I was very controlling, and I started to surrender a lot more. And I also started to realize my own imperfections. I used to try to cover up my imperfections with pride and beating the chest of, you know, how great I am. But actually, God started showing me how imperfect I was and how much I actually needed him.
John was baptized on Palm Sunday, 2007. So Easter is a very special time for him.
Through the resurrection, it cements everything I believe as a Christian, that Jesus came here. He came to teach us. He came to die for us. And most importantly, he came to give us life. God just loves me for me, that I don't have to do anything to get his love.
Yeah, it's interesting what the Buddha said. Christianity is spiritual cheating. First you believe, then you receive. That's exactly what it is. It's not cheating. It's what God has so freely given. In our own, we somehow don't think we deserve that. We think we've got to earn it, that we somehow have to make God happy. God's already happy with you. He already loves you. And he loves you so much, he doesn't want to leave you where you are. He wants to transform you. He wants to save you. And he's willing to do it if you just ask him. Believe and you will receive. Do the same prayer that John prayed. Jesus, if you're there, if this is real, could you show me? And if you pray that with all of your heart, he'll show up. Well, that's all the time we have for this program. We leave you this wonderful word from John chapter 4. But the time is coming when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. The Father is looking for those who will worship him that way. God bless you. We'll see you again.